Hey, welcome to another episode of the Smarter Tech Podcast. My name is Nick, the EMF guy Pineault. I'm the author of the non-tinfoil guide to EMFs, the electro-pollution fix course, and a bunch more. I try to come up with educational solutions to spread awareness about the dangers of electromagnetic fields. But ironically, I'm also contributing to a big problem, which is this. A lot of people who come across the topic of electro-pollution realize that, yes, their cell phone might not be safe. Yes, their computer might not be safe. Yes, their router might not be safe. And yes, those infamous cell towers that pretty much everyone hates to see, they cause fear because they're not safe. And the problem might happen when people focus on that fear too much. And the question has been asked to me before, for example, by my friend Ari Witten of the Energy Blueprint podcast, and he asked me this. He said, Nick, do you think that people who spend too much time worrying about EMFs might in fact make themselves sicker or to a greater extent than the impact of electropollution itself? And it's hard to quantify, right? But for sure, overstressing and overfearing EMFs, even if you're personally affected, doesn't help, right? It doesn't contribute to greater health. It might just do the opposite. And I was really reluctant to do an episode about that because I really didn't have anything more than my opinion to share. But that did change when I came across the work of Dr. Joe Dispenza. So let me share my screen for a second, right here. And this is the main book that changed my mind and that really told me, you know what, this is a major effect and I need to share it with people who follow my work. We need to talk about it, we need to think about it, and we need to be mindful about our reaction to these news and to this electropollution. You are the placebo, making your mind matter. And Dr. Joe Dispenza, this is not some type of new age stuff and wishful thinking slash wishing to the universe stuff or any of that stuff. So it looks at the placebo effect in medicine and how proven it is that some people, if they think something's gonna work, it is more likely to work, or in fact, their biological responses can still be there. So the placebo in a lot of drugs, for example, people take the placebo in the placebo group instead of the actual drug, and yet they still experience benefits. So the conclusion is that your mind is a powerful tool, and if you're convinced that you're getting healed, well, that thought stimulates your body's healing response because you feel better, you sleep better, and a lot more reasons. You're more aligned, I think, in your biology and for many mechanisms that are probably elusive to researchers, you heal faster or you have real responses that can be measured. It doesn't mean that you can simply think yourself into curing any illness. That's not the point. But it does point towards the fact that we should have a specific attitude and specific rituals where we imagine good outcomes in our lives when it comes to healing from something and also from anything else, right? So, and some people have these in forms of prayers, if you pray for religion, or it can be meditation, or it can be other practices like gratitude journal, for example. Thinking good thoughts actually helps you think more good thoughts and actually helps you have a better life and feel healthier. But Dr. Joe Dispenza also talks about the nocebo effect. And the nocebo effect is interesting because it's the opposite and it's not as studied in medicine. And the nocebo effect is thinking that something is going to harm you and then it does, even though the thing was not there. So, for example, here's a good article that I came across, a psychosomatic study of contagious dermatitis. This is a classic study from 1962, which Dr. Joe Dispenza talked about in his book. And what happened here is that basically there's two different arms of that research. You had 13 in the study reported by Ikemi and Nakagawa, so that's the one. 13 students were touched on one arm with leaves from a harmless tree, but they were told that these were from a tree that produces similar effect to poison ivy. So on the other arm, the subjects were touched with poisonous leaves, but they were led to believe that they were harmless. So let's say on this arm, it's a harmless type of leaf, but I'm told this is poisonous. And on this arm, it is poisonous, but I'm told it's not, right? So it kind of plays with your brain, and researchers wanted to see, well, what would happen if people believe that the poisonous thing is harmless and that the harmless thing is poisonous. So all 13 subjects displayed a skin reaction to the harmless leaf. So they thought it's poisonous, and they think it's so hard that they in fact cause, psychologically, they cause a biological reaction, which is mind-blowing to me. And only two reacted to the poisonous leaves. And these were on people that have skin conditions. So maybe they've been conditioned to fear that certain things will impact their biology. Who knows exactly? But it's very, very interesting, because there's not as much science as with the placebo effect, but there's sufficient science. For example, this review, Nocebo Effect in Medicine, that's in a German journal here in 2012, and I'm going to have all these in the show notes. But basically, there's table two here that talks about different things. Exposure tests in known drug allergy. So basically, the placebo in 600 patients who had known drug allergy, and they were told, you know, you're getting this drug you're allergic to, so you might have a reaction. So they conditioned themselves to have a bad reaction. Well, 27% reported nausea, stomach pains, and itching on the placebo. Again, the placebo is a pill that is nothing else than a sugar pill, supposed to do nothing. A quarter of all participants who got the fake pill had allergic reactions to something they're not allergic to. Interesting. Here, drug allergy, again, 435 people, 32% reported adverse events. Two RCTs, randomized controlled trials, fatigue in advanced cancers, 79% reported sleep problems on placebo. Think about it for a second. 80% of people that are not initially handpicked to be suggestible or anything, they're just like you and I. They're told, you know what, this is advanced cancer. So I'm thinking we're talking about chemotherapy. You're going to take this pill, and you know what, it might cause side effects. Or maybe the doc doesn't tell them that, but people in today's society know that when you take chemo, you feel like crap. So they expect to feel like crap. They get a placebo pill that does nothing to their biology, and then 80% report sleep problems. So psychologically, you've conditioned yourself to have a reaction. So you can review this if you're interested in the science, but the point here is that if you condition yourself to have a reaction, chances are that you will. Either your psychological conditioning will exacerbate your reaction. So normally you would have a small reaction, and now you have a large one or a large effect. Or in certain situations, it could create the reaction itself. So maybe you could think that you're exposed to EMFs to a certain degree, like you see a cell tower and you think, my God, normally a cell tower gives me brain fog because I know I'm a sensitive individual. and you see a cell tower and you don't realize it's not pointing towards you, and you don't initially realize it's not leading to substantial exposure. Well, what can happen is that literally the thought that this cell tower might make you sick might make you sick in this situation, just like the nocebo effect. So my point today was to really, really be mindful of that effect and realize that once you're educated about electropollution, and once you know that you're personally a sensitive individual, you try to minimize your exposure as much as possible, and then you also try to control how your mind is playing tricks with you. And that's very important. And that's a program that has been recommended to me through different doctors, Dynamic Neural Retraining System. For people who have electro-hypersensitivity, it's part of the things that can help you retrain your nervous system and also retrain your body's response. And that's an important thing. I used to be a little bit more electrosensitive, if you will, and I played tricks with myself in various situations. I even thought that my wife had kept her cell phone open at night, and I slept badly just because I thought it was not on airplane mode. And I tossed and turned, and then I told her, "Your cell phone was open this night. You know I'm sensitive, and I cannot sleep." Well, it turns out in many situations, it was on airplane mode. So I convinced myself that I was likely to have these effects, and I caused them. So I'm not saying, right, this is a touchy subject. I'm not saying that people who suffer from microwave illness / electro hypersensitivity have simply a psychological reaction. It's not true. I have had many exposures myself where first I have the effects, I feel fatigued, I feel brain fog, and then I realize it's a source of EMFs, like a router. Happened many, many times. So that's not the nocebo effect at play. It's the opposite. You first have the symptoms, and then you realize what the source of these symptoms, or what's triggering these symptoms, is. But at the same time, we have to recognize that the more sensitive you get, the more frustrating it is that everyone's on a cell phone, you see the routers everywhere, you see the cell phones, and I think the greater your propensity might be to experience this nocebo effect and to start getting tricking yourself into getting more effects than it needs to happen. So my message is this: if you're listening to my work or you're sharing this with other people, recognize that fear-mongering around EMS, saying, electropollution is killing us slowly, we're frogs in boiling water, and these analogies, it's all good, but at the same time, we have to recognize that we have to calmly and mindfully acknowledge that this is in my opinion, a major issue with the environment. It is a major issue, debilitating in some cases, with certain people who unfortunately suffer from extreme cases of electro-hypersensitivity. But at the same time, we somehow need to spend time calming down our minds and being okay with the fact that we cannot shield ourselves completely. There's only so much we can do. And then that advocacy, like most people who follow me are doing, spreading the word, changing regulations, protecting yourself, and changing this glaring problem will take some time. I don't want to say decades to then not be discouraged myself, but it will take a lot of time. And we're getting there. However, in the meantime, we have to live a healthy life. So it doesn't mean to ignore the problem, put your hand in the sand, right? Quite the opposite, but it means to be mindful of your reaction and be mindful of your own negativity. If you see cell phone towers and you start having a bad day, Well, you know, it happened to me and it sucks. And it's something that we need to fix around the messaging around this issue. So we need to be very, very mindful about how we think about these things. So I hope you like this episode and spend time in nature, spend time being mindful, remind yourself that you're still here, smile, spend time with family if you can and when you can, and enjoy yourself and minimize your exposure. Sure, I have a lot of resources that I share about that, but also manage your psychological health and your mind, because these matter a lot, and we don't want to spend all this time under a stress response and make ourselves sicker than we need to. So this life is beautiful, even though this world is pretty broken with a lot of problems. It is a beautiful life, and you can manage your health and your reactions when you are mindful about these things. So I hope you like this episode, and I'll talk to you next time. Bye-bye.